Hi, so I thought I'll just make a little video for you to tell you how to study for your final exam. This is a comprehensive final exam, so you have to know everything from chapter 1 to chapter 10. So I'm going to go through all of these one by one so I can tell you what's important in all of these. So I'm going to get my list here. So first of all, you need to go through all your homework, all the worksheets, all PowerPoint sheets and all of that stuff so that you can prepare. I think if you go through all of those, you should feel confident, okay, going into the exam. So you should be fine at that point. So make sure you review all of that. Just practice again, all right? For your exam, you should make sure that you have a calculator, a periodic table, and let's see, any kind of scrap paper that you need. And of course, the cheat sheet, you know, the solubility rules, all right, if you need those. So make sure you have those with you before you sit. The exam is about 2 hours long, so make sure you have, you know, that time set out for that much of the exam, all right? Okay, so let's go through chapter one. Chapter one, you learned about the scientific method, which was such a small topic, I can give you only one question, okay, out of it. So it's not such a big deal. However, measurement was really big, all right? So again, you should know all the SI units. Regarding the non-SI to SI conversions, I give you those conversions, but the SI you must know, okay, by yourself. So make sure you know how to set up dimension analysis and be able to do density calculation, temperature calculations, okay, and all of that. And you can probably see that you've been using those measurements all the way along, all right? So please know your units well. In chapter two, you learned about the atomic structure, you learned about the periodic table and nomenclature. Again, you have seen that this is very important. We saw it again and again later on in chapter seven and so on. So make sure that you learn the atomic structure well. The one thing that I think we can kind of tone back a little bit on this one would be the history, okay, of the atomic structure. So if that's interest to you and you want to learn it, that's fine. But as far as the exam is concerned, I can give you only one question out of it because there's so much more to ask you. So if you felt that you don't remember what J.J. Thompson did, well, that's fine. Don't worry about it, okay, so much. And remember, you have bonus options, all right, in the exam. So if you miss quite one question, it's not a big deal. Make sure you do all of them, okay, and make sure you answer all of them, whether it's right or wrong. Okay, nomenclature, I can't stress how important that is, okay? So make sure you learn the nomenclature. Regarding the polyatomic ions, try not to have a cheat sheet for that because it's really important for me personally that you know all the polyatomic ions. If you have a cheat sheet, I can't tell, but try not to. And in some cases, I already give you the formulas. So, you know, try to conserve your time more for the calculation rather than looking through your papers for anything. So try to memorize some of these things, okay? So anyhow, master the nomenclature. Regarding the periodic table, you should know, of course, that, you know, the side is the metals, the non-metals, and so on and so forth. In chapter three, we didn't miss anything, okay? We did everything in there. We figure out the moles, we did the Avogadro's number, then we calculated mass percents, we calculated molecular formula. The only thing we did not do with the molecular formula is we did not go from grams of carbon to the moles, okay? We actually took, you know, a percent, okay, from there. So you had the percent of carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, or whatever element, and then you calculated moles from there. So if you look at your examples, homeworks, you will see what I mean, okay, by that. So in any case, that's the one thing that we did not really do in that chapter, but we did calculate molecular formulas, okay? So make sure you do that. And then of course, stoichiometry, okay? So you have to know stoichiometry. There is no getting out of it. You saw it again in chapter four and then again in chapter five, okay? And so you have to know it. With the stoichiometry comes the mole ratios. With the stoichiometry comes balancing equations, writing equations. With stoichiometry also comes percent yield, okay, and limiting reagent. So it's not such a small topic, it's a huge topic, and this is one thing that you should not skip, okay? I generally tell you what to skip, but this one is not one of those things that you should skip, okay? So make sure you master it. And then we go on to chapter four. In chapter four, the first thing you learned about was electrolytes, okay? What is strong, what is weak? Then you learned about the different kinds of reaction, precipitation, acid-base, neutralization, and redox. And yes, please know all of them. You should be able to classify those reactions. We learned also about molarity in there. So we learned moles over liters. That's how you calculate molarity. You learned dilutions, how to make solutions. And then of course you did the titrations, okay? Gravimetric analysis, and that is called solution stoichiometry, okay? So again, go through the PenCast, go through the PowerPoint problems, the solved problems, you know, and you have the worksheets also. Go through those and see what kind of problem you had with any of those. And if you did, you're most welcome to email me and ask me, okay, any of those things. So in any case, go over all that. Nothing you can skip there. Okay, you must know all of that. And if you're going on to Gen Chem 2, then you will definitely need all of this. Okay, there is hardly anything here that I can tell you to skip. Okay, at this point. So then we go on to Chapter 5. In Chapter 5, you, of course, you have to know all the laws. Charles Law, Boyle's Law, Avogadro's Law. Dalton's Law is the only one that I kind of scale back on. So if you want to kind of skip Dalton's Law, that's fine. Okay, which is the partial pressures. The only thing I do with partial pressure is collecting gas over water, okay, in stoichiometry. That's all that I do in there. So make sure you learn all the laws. Regarding the laws and all the gases problems, the nice thing about them is that they're all formula based, okay? And because it's formula based, all you have to do is, you know, look at the formula and see which one to use, okay, for solving the problem. So make sure you keep that periodic table handy, the one that I've posted for you, because it has all the formulas you need, okay? So you're not looking around for any formulas. All the constants should be given there too. So you shouldn't have to hunt for these things during the exam, okay? So learn how to use those formulas. Calculating density, calculating the molar mass, again, you have formulas for that, okay? Stoichiometry, gas stoichiometry, there are only two kinds of problems you can get for gas stoichiometry. One is, you know, trying to do the mole ratio first or doing the gas law first, okay? And so try to see the two different problems that we solved for stoichiometry in gases, and that's about it, okay? The last part we did not do, which is, you know, the, what do you call, the speed of molecules, okay? And the van der Waals, okay, equation. So you can skip all of that. That's not a problem. And I can, you know, I won't give you any questions in that, I promise. Okay. Then chapter 7, we get to quantum numbers. In quantum numbers, we learned a little bit about the history part of it. And in the history, again, if you want to skip that part, that's okay. I can ask you only one question about it. Okay, that's about it. So regarding the history of Heisenberg principle, you know, and all of that, if you want to skip that, that's fine. And of course, I don't give you any calculations, okay, from that part. So definitely you can skip that portion of it. So the history of it, you know, fine. If you got it the first time, that's great. If you didn't get it, it's not a big deal, all right? But the quantum numbers, you should, okay? So the four quantum numbers that we learned, that's the one, those are the ones you should know, okay? Which is the N, L, M, L, and M, S numbers. You should know which one is right, which one is wrong. Again, the deal about chapter 7, it's a very tiny chapter, okay? So it's such a small chapter that maximum questions I can give you is two questions. So if this is something that you did not understand before, it was very abstract for you, then you're most welcome to skip it, okay? The only thing I ask you then is make sure that everything else you do is good, okay? So that, you know, if you skip this portion, at least you have other places where you can get points, all right? So, but I think quantum numbers are easy. I think you can handle it, okay? And so go over it. Chapter 8, then we got to electronic configurations. And you saw that in chapter 8 we were pretty much into electronic configurations, okay? And I don't know if you saw my lecture about how to use the periodic table to fill out the electronic configurations. It's fairly easy, so make sure you learn how to use the periodic table to do electronic configurations. So you have the S block, P block, D block, and then you can fill according to, you know, where the element is. It's quite easy to do. So remember the exceptions, okay, for the electronic configurations, which happens usually in the D block, okay? So when you're trying to fill the D block after you get into the new shell, okay? So regarding the core and the valence, you actually fill the valence and then you go back into the core to fill the D and then come out again, okay? So remember those exceptions. There's another one of chromium, okay, which you'll remember. Okay, the other thing about electronic configuration that you should know is the electronic configuration of ions, which is covered more in chapter 9, okay? But I think I did a little bit of it in chapter 8, so make sure you do that. And then, of course, there was the periodic properties, okay? And the periodic properties, it is the trends that you have, okay? even if you write all the trends on the periodic table and use them during the exam, it doesn't matter because you still have to see it, okay? My suggestion is, of course, try to remember all these trends, okay, if you can, because again, this shows that you learned the material, okay, and you're not just using a cheat sheet for anything. So please make sure that you try to remember how the atomic size changes and how the ionization energy changes in the periodic table, okay, and try not to use cheat sheets for this. So in any case, remember the periodic properties. The one portion that I did not do in chapter 8 was the last part where you had all the different groups, okay, and the properties of that. That's actually a very interesting part, but I didn't have enough time to do it, and there's not really much I can ask, okay, in that also. The only thing I ask is towards the end, or I think towards the beginning. It's in the PowerPoints also, where I ask about how do you make acids and bases, and so how, what kind of oxides do you need, okay? So non-metallic oxides will give you acids, and basic oxides are going to give you base, metallic oxides will give you bases when you mix them in water, okay? So that's about it for chapter 8. So electronic configuration was the big thing, okay, in there. And of course, you have to remember that we are talking about things like how to fill the not only just the SPDF notation, but also the boxes, okay, and how to fill them out. So you fill them by the Aufbau principle, Pauli's exclusion principle, and all of that. Even if you don't know what they're called, at least follow those principles, okay? All right. So then we get to chapter 9, which is the bonding and Lewis structure. If you're going on to Gen Chem 2, if you're going on to organic, all of these things are really important, okay? So chapter 9 and chapter 10 are probably the most important chapters you can carry with you, okay, to the next level. So please take some time and go over this and practice as many Lewis structures as possible. You have the PowerPoints practice. You also have the worksheets, okay, that you can look at. So go through that. So bonding, again, there are two kinds, ionic and covalent. In the ionic bonding, you write a different kind of Lewis structure with the brackets, and then with the covalent bonding, you show the bonds, okay, in there. So make sure you learn how to do that. Make sure you show all the lone pair of electrons also, okay, when you show Lewis structures. So there are single bond, double bonds, triple bonds, okay, that you have. There's no quadruple bonds, so, you know, learn about how to make those bonds. In there, try to also practice structures in which you can have more than one central atom. So things like water, H2O, CH4, methane, they have only one central atom, and then there are some others that I've given you in the practice sheets which have more than one central atom, okay? So make sure you go over that, because that's helpful in the next chapter also, okay? So Lewis structures, then you have to know the exceptions to the Lewis structures, okay, which is, they are all based on the octet rule. So that's how bonding is based on. So you have to know the exceptions to that, which is that, you know, you can have less than 8 electrons, you can have more than 8 electrons, that's expanded shell, and then you can have a single electron left over, okay, which is nitrogen. That's the naughty one. So that one gives you an exception there, okay? So know those three exceptions, because that will really help you with the Lewis structures, especially when it comes to phosphorus and sulfur and chlorine, bromine, some of these things which are actually below the third row in the periodic table. Because as soon as you have anything below the third row on the periodic table, you can start having exceptions, okay? And so make sure you go over that, so you know that if you're given H2SO4, if you're given PCl5, you're not freaking out, okay, that, oh my god, where do I put the five chlorines, okay, in there? Because you should know phosphorus can have five bonds, okay, in there. So in any case, practice your Lewis structures, okay, as much as possible. In this chapter, you also learned about electronegativity. Again, very, very important thing here. So learn about electronegativity, learn about polarity of the bonds, okay, in there, because you use that in chapter 10, okay? So make sure you do that. And then let's go on to chapter 10. I think that's all there is in chapter 9. I didn't do resonance, okay, too much. So I will not ask you anything about resonance in chapter 9, because that's a little bit of a higher concept, and sometimes it's a little bit, you know, hard to do. In any case, if there's anything that I left out, just email me, okay, and ask me. All right, chapter 10 is about shapes. Cannot tell you how important that is, okay? Again, if you're going to 1046, if you're going on to organic, this is going to be super, super important for you, okay? So learn about the shapes of the molecules, whether it's a tetrahedral, whether it's trigonal planar, all right, what kind it is. The Axe formula is really your answer to everything. Okay, learn your ACTS formula well. Once you know the ACTS formula, you can answer pretty much anything. All right, but to know the ACTS formula well, you have to have the right Lewis structure. Okay, so if your Lewis structure is not correct, your ACTS formula is wrong, then your shape is wrong, and then the next thing that we do after that is polarity of the molecule, which is means if the molecule has dipole moment, then dipole moment is wrong. Okay, so all of these things are interconnected, starting with Lewis structure. Okay, so if your Lewis structure is wrong, everything else is going to be wrong. So make sure you learn the Lewis structures, which will then tell you about the ACTS formula, which will tell you about the shape of the molecule. Remember, there are two things about shapes. There's electronic geometry, and then there is the actual geometry, okay, which is the shape of the molecule. Electronic geometry has to do with how many electron groups are around the central atom. The shape is the actual shape. Okay, so NH3 actually has four electron groups, but the shape is actually trigonal pyramidal, and the electronic geometry is tetrahedral because it has four electron groups. Okay, look at the tables that I've given you in the PowerPoint. Those are very helpful. And then of course the polarity of molecules. So if you don't know the shape of the molecule, you will not be able to do the polarity, because if you think something is linear when actually something is bent, then we'll have issues. Okay, and so anything linear may not be polar, but as soon as it's bent, it's going to be polar. All right, so make sure you learn your shapes well. The last thing that we did from this chapter is valence bond theory, which is hybridization, and I know I will do a little teeny bit of this. And the main thing I want you to focus on in this one is how to use the ACTS formula to find the hybridization. So if it is AX4, for example, AX4 is going to be sp3 hybridization. AX3E, which is also four electron groups, okay, that's also going to be sp3. So learn about that from the table I have provided you, okay, and hopefully that will help. Valence bond theory has to do with hybridization, okay, which is actually mixing of orbitals. So it's not super complicated, but you know, it's something a little bit different. Just one little bit thing I will tell about valence bond is that if you have single bonds, those are all called sigma bonds, okay, and those are hybridized. If you have double bonds, okay, like oxygen, okay, that has a double bond in there, one of the bond is going to be a sigma bond, the other one is going to be pi bond. The sigma bond again is a hybridized, the pi bond is not hybridized. Which one is which? It doesn't matter, okay, but one is pi, one is sigma, okay. And so if you have a triple bond, one is sigma, two are pi, okay, in there. So that's how you do for single, double and triple bonds in hybridizations, all right? But in any case, look through the table and then you will see, and hopefully that will help you out. But in any case, those are all the chapters we have done in Gen Chem 1. So, you know, going from chapter 1 to chapter 10, hopefully this little summary helped you out a little bit. You need definitely the calculator for the first few parts, so the chapter 1 through 5, and then from 7 to 10, you just need your good skills, okay, and good memory. For this, a lot of it is the process actually, okay, there's very little memorization except for, you know, like the polyatomic ions and stuff like that, but a lot of it is actually working through. So try to understand the concepts because it will help you in the future also, okay. It's not just about finishing this course, although for some of you it might be, okay, but still. Alright, so that is how you should study for the final exam. I think I've covered everything in there. There's hardly anything to skip, okay, and there was some things to skip, okay, which I did tell you. But in any case, alright, I think that's all I have to say. Watch out for the bonus questions and make sure you answer everything, okay, in there. If you have any questions, definitely email me. Bye.